Welcome all. Today we are going to learn about Rorschach inkblot test. We have learned that personality assessment is majorly done using two techniques. One is through the use of self-report measures and two through the use of projective techniques. Self-report measures rely on the trait approach and they try to measure or assess personality on the basis of the traits inherent within the person. Projective techniques, on the other hand, are based on the psychoanalytic theory of personality and they work on the assumption that when confronted with a stimuli, particularly stimuli which are not very clear in nature or which are ambiguous in nature, what happens is that people tend to project their inner feelings, memories, conflicts or experiences on the ambiguous stimuli. We have learned about the defense mechanism called projection, where people tend to shift on to others their own thoughts, feelings, memories and conflicts. This projective techniques work on this very idea of projection. Rorschach inkblot test was developed by Hermann Rorschach. We have already learned that it works on the idea of projection, or it is based on the idea of projection, the defense mechanism of projection. The stimuli which are presented in the Rorschach inkblot test are ambiguous and unstructured. Rorschach inkblot test is a test which contains cards which have inkblots on them. So inkblots are highly unstructured and ambiguous or unclear. The inkblots used in Rorschach cards are ambiguous, they are not clear forms, hence there is a lot of scope for the person who is looking at the cards to project his inner world of feelings, thoughts, conflicts, memories and experiences on the inkblots which the person is looking at. Rorschach inkblot test has 10 cards in total. 5 of the cards are black or grey in colour and the rest 5 have colours. You can see that these are the kind of inkblots which are shown in Rorschach inkblot test. So you can see that these images do not have very clear forms. How one interprets each inkblot depends on how one thinks, what are the major concerns in the life of the person, what are the major thoughts, what are the major feelings, or the inner world of the person comprising of all the feelings, memories, conflicts, major concerns, major ideas at the moment, all govern or all get reflected in the person's interpretation of these inkblots. Now let us understand the administration of Rorschach inkblot test, or how is the Rorschach inkblot test administered. So there is a person, a psychologist or clinical psychologist, a counselor, who is the test administrator, and the other person who is the respondent. As you can see here, the cards are presented to the respondent one at a time, and the questions which are asked to the respondent are, what might this be? Each card, each figure has to be responded to in terms of these two questions. What might this be and what does it remind you of? So the respondent has to answer these two questions while interpreting or while looking at the inkblots, each of the inkblots. Number two, there is no time limit to make the response. The respondent can take as much time as he or she wants. There is no limit to the number of responses which the respondent wants to make. So someone can make more than one responses to an inkblot, to one card. For example, a person might interpret one card in more than one ways. So there is total freedom to the respondent to give as many responses to a card as he or she wants and to take as much time as the respondent wants. Three, in addition to the responses made by the respondent, the test administrator also keeps a record of the time taken for each response, the position of holding the card, the emotional expression of the respondent and non-verbal behavior of the respondent. So the test administrator keeps a record of all the responses, notes down. In fact, the administrator notes down the responses which the respondents make. And apart from noting down the responses, the test administrator also has to keep a track of how much time the person is taking to respond, what are the emotional expressions of the person, what are the nonverbal behaviors of the person, and what is the position in which the respondent is holding the card. This phase, when the test administrator shows the card to the respondent one by one and notes down the responses and other things which I just mentioned, this phase is called the free association phase of administration. There are two phases of test administration of Rorschach-Inkblot test. One is the free association phase, where the respondent is shown the cards one by one and the responses and many other factors are also noted by the test administrator. Once all the cards have been shown to the person and the respondent has responded to all the cards and the test administrator has noted down, the first phase is over, the free association phase is over. The second phase involves going back to the cards all over again. Starting from the first card, the examiner now, the test administrator now asks the person what actually prompted the person to respond in the way the person has responded. So each of the card is shown again to the respondent and the test administrator asks the person as to what determined, what in the card, what in the ink blot determined the response which the person made. This is the second phase of Rorschach-Inkblot test administration, and this phase is called the inquiry phase. Now, once the administration is complete, the second step is to score the test or to give scores to the various responses which the respondent has made. Now, scoring basically involves four dimensions: one, location; two, content; three, originality; and four, determinants. We'll look at each of these one by one. Location involves five kinds of symbols. The first symbol is W, capital W, which means that the person, the respondent, has been able to see the card as a whole, which means that the response that the person has given to a particular card involves the whole ink blot and not the parts. So the person has been able to perceive the whole ink blot as a figure. Responses are scored as small w, where the respondent has failed to see the card as a whole or has focused on parts of the ink blot and perceived forms within the parts of the ink blot and not perceived the card as a whole, the ink blot as a whole. Capital D is given when the respondent gives major details, whereas small d is given when the respondent gives minor details involving petty issues or less important matters. Small s is given to those responses which are to the white spaces within the main outlines. So within the ink blots there are outlines, and between the outlines are small white spaces. Responses which are focused on those white spaces in between the outlines are symbolized as small s. Coming to the second dimension, which is the content. Each response is also analyzed on the basis of the content of the response. Responses involving human forms are given capital H, while those involving animal forms are given capital A. Responses which have animal details are symbolized as AD. Responses which have human details are symbolized as HD. Natural objects such as rivers or green fields are symbolized as N, and inanimate objects like lampshade, pot, etc. are symbolized as O. The third dimension on which each of the responses is analyzed is the dimension of originality. So the popular responses, the responses which are made by people generally, are referred to as popular responses. So these are the responses which occur commonly. These are symbolized as capital P, and the responses which are very original or new which the respondent has made are symbolized as capital O. The fourth and the last dimension on which each of the responses is analyzed is the determinants. There are four determinants: form, color, movement, and shading. The response which involves a form is scored as capital F. The response which has dominance of color, for example, blood or fire, is symbolized as C. The response which has movement, for example, a person can see two people sitting and having a cup of tea, or running, or maybe dancing, or standing. So these are the responses which involve movement, and these are scored as capital M. Responses which involve shading, for example, smooth surface or smoke or maybe shadow, are scored as capital K. Now, once the scoring has been done, we know that how many F a person has, how many K a person has, how many W's a person has. So we have a list of number of responses made by the person for each of the four dimensions, as well as the categories within each of these four dimensions. The next step is to interpret what these numbers mean. Now, interpretation of these numbers, of the scores on Rorschach, is a very complicated task, and it needs a lot of training and expertise to be able to interpret Rorschach. So what we are doing right now is that we are trying to just have a glimpse of Rorschach interpretation. The interpretation as such is highly complex and very subjective. So just to give you an idea, here are some rules which are followed while interpreting the scores on Rorschach inkblot test. As the bullet point 1 goes, if the number of W responses, that is the responses made using the whole figure, the whole inkblot, are more in number than the responses involving details, major or minor details, then the person is assumed to be mature, intelligent, and the person possesses ability to synthesize, because the person is able to see the figure as a whole and not go into details or break parts. The person has a capacity to view things holistically as complete wholes. Coming to the second bullet point, if the responses involve more color responses, the respondent is assumed to be an extrovert. If there is a dominance of shading responses, it is assumed that the respondent is having issues such as anxiety or depression. In case there is a dominance of movement responses, it is assumed that the person, the respondent, has an imaginative life, or the person has a very rich imagination. So, as I told you in the beginning, interpretation of Rorschach is a complex task which involves both objective and subjective measures, and it needs immense expertise to be able to interpret a Rorschach inkblot test. What we have learned in this lesson is just a glimpse of the Rorschach inkblot test, which is what you require for your examination. So that is all for today's lecture. Happy learning!